Tantor Audio, a division of Recorded Books, presents Shadow Magic by Jaida Jones and Danielle Bennett. Narrated by Cornell Collins. Chapter 1. Mamoru. On the seventh and final day of mourning for the loss of the war, my brother Isul came to my chambers to tell me that our father was dead. I had been expecting the news for some time. There was ritual ensconced in the hour of his death. This, on the seventh hour of the seventh day, which made it all the more unsurprising to see the truth in my brother's eyes, lining his mouth and hardening his jaw. The news was no shock to us. Our father had taken his life in apology for our defeat at the hands of the Volstovics, as we always knew he would. All we could do now was join him or suffer his legacy. For either of these, we were equally prepared. My brother came with black robes and no coal to line his eyes, rather than with knives of ceremony. I saw then that his decision had been made. In this, as in all things, I would follow the path my brother had chosen for us. Outside the window, just past the quiet gardens of raked sand and contemplation, loomed the broken roof of the magician's dome, like the rounded edge of a broken sky as seen from above, where the gods once sat and watched over us in dominion. It was far enough away that it looked almost like a shattered bowl overset, or a forsaken cup of tea dropped by clumsy hands. What remained of the dome was charred. Here and there, the blue stone sparkled, but it was no more than feeble protest in the bleaching sunlight. The destruction of the dome had been a particularly crushing blow to our people, though perhaps not the one the Volstovics intended. We were not a society based heavily on magic. War had forced our hand in advancing the skill of our magicians. And though in later years the dome became a perfect gathering place for the magicians, it had first been built as a temple of worship for our gods. Its demolition had been a huge blow to the morale of the people, as a symbol more than a practical structure. Isul pushed his fingers through his hair, each heavy braid a commendation of his prowess as our father's general. He was on the verge of pacing, but practice kept him fearsomely still. "The delegation arrives tomorrow," he said. "We shall meet them as planned." The entire city must have known by then, or would soon know, of my father the Emperor's death. From somewhere deep in the green garden just below my window, I heard the sudden throaty wail of a songbird, trembling upon the air. The sound echoed the faint trembling of my brother's fists, and I averted my eyes. The dew had barely left the leaves. "We'll meet them as though nothing has changed," I said, with the hint of a question. Isul's eyes flashed in anger. "Nothing has changed," he insisted. I sank to my knees before him at once when the look in his eyes betrayed the lie. Everything had changed. Our father was dead, and my brother the Emperor in his stead. And I had shown grave disrespect to my new lord by neglecting to bow to him. Shock had overwhelmed all memory of protocol. I struggled with my shame and could not lift my eyes.
Mamoru,
Isul said, in place of how he had once addressed me.
Brother, do not do this. Rise.
I swear to serve you, I said, instead of obeying him. This old custom was more important even than brotherhood. We were no longer two princes, and I had wasted too much time already without acknowledging his new place as Emperor of the Kihan. In 7 ways I shall serve you. In 7 ways I shall offer my life to you. In 7 ways, if it is in my power, I shall die beneath your blade, as your blade, for your blade. May your reign be prosperous and long. Then, closing my eyes, I strayed from the words I'd known since before I could form them with my own mouth, the prayer with which I was born. May the people love you as I do, I whispered. Isul. My brother held up his hand, fingers spread wide. As always, it was a small sign. But the shame I felt was assuaged by the openness of the gesture. If my brother's fingers had been all together, I would have sensed his anger at my actions. But I had never given my brother cause to close his hand and his heart against me.
Enough,
he said, his voice cold. He must have already been preparing mentally for the arrival of the delegates.
Rise.
I did as he'd bidden me. It was as things would be between us from then on. And it was as things had always been. For I respected my brother's elder position just as I loved him. And it stilled the quaking in my chest a little to know that not everything had changed. What? I held my tongue, breathing the way I'd been taught to hide the uncertainty in my voice, my movements. What happens now, Isul? He shook his head, looking out over the gardens as though expecting to find some answer within their soothing patterns. Of course, my brother was a man who needed no such reassurance. I myself felt an unbidden longing. The sand had no need to worry as to what direction to take, what shape, what form. There was a plan in mind for the sand, and it had only to follow. My brother and I had no such luck. I fiddled with the smooth, soft fabric of my overlong sleeves, trying not to seem as though I was waiting on my brother's response. Surely the new responsibility was weighing heavily on his mind, and he would have a great many things to discuss with the warlords, our own diplomats, before the delegation from Volstov arrived tomorrow. The proper thing, I knew, was to beg my leave, expecting to be informed of what my new role within the negotiations would be at a later hour, when my brother had taken his time to sort it out. Knowing this, however, did not preclude my stubborn desire to stay nearby. After all, with our father dead, Isul was all I had of family, and I the same to him. For even as the elder prince, my father had not yet seen fit to find my brother a wife. Now he was emperor, but still my brother. And I would not leave until I'd found some sign that I'd not lost him to dark thoughts of what was to come. But he would not look at me. Isul, I began and felt reassurance opening like a blossom within me. It seemed then that I knew from some unseen source of certainty. that everything would be healed in time for my brother and for me.
For our people, for all the Kihan.
We would put our heads together, Isul and I, along with my father's old advisors, and we would manage the task set to us as best we could. I hadn't yet grown past the childish notion that there was nothing we couldn't accomplish together. And indeed, even our father had been proud to claim that Isul's strengths balanced against mine so fittingly, that together we made a nearly invincible pair. Today was going to be onerous for him, and I could not expect reassurances. Rather, it was my place now to reassure him in his new station. For if I did not support our new emperor with all my being, then what man could be expected to do so? We would find ourselves within this new rhythm, once we'd settled into this new way of being. It was only a matter of time. My brother's face turned toward mine and then to the door as Kuje cleared his throat just beyond, feeling the silence my brother had left in the wake of my appeals.
Your pardon,
Isul said to me, sounding distant somehow, but how could I blame him? He moved with a steadiness of purpose that I longed to imitate, and slid open the door on the kneeling figure before us.
My Lord Emperor, Kuje began,
proving that news travelled faster among the servants than I'd have believed possible, and that my brother's decision was known now throughout the great house, if not the palace proper.
Word has been sent that the delegation from Volstov is set to arrive rather earlier than we anticipated. Earlier.
My brother repeated. He did not need to phrase it as a question. It was Kuje's duty to anticipate and respond in kind.
We believe they may be here in a matter of hours, your supreme grace.
It was then that I envied Kuje's propriety in keeping his face averted. This way, he did not have to see my brother's expression at that moment,
terrible as the god's fire. Gather the warlords,
said my brother in a voice I didn't recognize. It was a voice that had commanded our warriors in the mountains.
We will hold council in the green room.
Kuje rose, clad all in mourning black. The sight of it seemed to remind my brother of something, for he lifted his hand, an emperor making his decision. I scarcely had time to marvel at the completeness of my brother's transformation, as though he'd been living all his life on its cusp.
Take the prince to be dressed, Isul commanded. The 7 days have passed, and the delegation must find us prepared to receive them with all due hospitality.
Kuje bowed, though not so low as to find himself on the floor once more, and turned to me with a waiting expectation I'd come to know well. Isul, I said. I was quiet enough, but I found myself unable to keep my silence entirely. It would have been different in the company of servants or the other warlords. But before his death, Kuje's father had served hours as Kuje did me. While he was not of distinguished blood, he was certainly trustworthy. Too trustworthy, in fact, for he had forgiven me many an error in decorum over the years. I didn't have my brother's facility in assuming the responsibilities of a prince, nor could I possibly imagine the weight on his shoulders now that he was emperor. Still, we were brothers. I could offer him comfort, if nothing else. We shall persevere. We had no other choice beyond that, save to perish in the attempt. But I left unsaid the second half of the old warrior's idiom, knowing it would only make my brother frown and Kuje regret teaching me such things in the first place.
Go with Cujo, said my brother.
His voice betrayed nothing but an iron calm that so reminded me of our father that for a moment I was overcome with a sharp awareness of how things were to change between us.
Then, return to your chambers. I will send for you. I bowed low to my brother, the Emperor. Despite his remonstrations to the contrary, it never occurred to me to act in any other way. We parted ways without further talk, and I found myself relieved for the silence. My brother never had such troubles as I with keeping his silence or maintaining the peace of his spirit. I was always at war with myself, my father had once said, and it seemed a quality I might never entirely lose. Kuje, too, said nothing. There were no lamps lit, nor were their servants moving swiftly and surely in preparation. The halls seemed like the winding passageways of a warrior's tomb. Luckily, there were tasks immediately to hand that would serve as ample distraction from this unfortunate comparison. While Kuje waited just outside the door, I slipped into the silent hot bath that had been drawn for me, holding my breath as I sank deep inside. The water was hot enough that I felt it might scald all my skin from my bones. A clean new bath. I knew with certainty that my brother had been strong enough not to shed a single tear for the father we had both lost. And not only our father, but our Lord Emperor as well. He had died the only noble death left for him, and though I mourned the victory for which we had all hoped, I could do nothing more than be a loyal son to him. The bath was swift, and the incense already burning when I stepped out. Servants came to dry me, twisting dry the braids of honor in my hair. This for the victory at Dragonbone Pass. This for the victory of the tunnels. This for the victory of the Forsaken Man. This for the victory of the auspicious moon. I bore no scars from those battles. I was a general, a second son. I rode no horse, but did the best I could to keep the men serving me from dying. In the later months of the war, when the fighting had grown too fierce for an unexpected general such as me, the Council of Warlords had recommended my return to the palace. In place of earning more braids, I had attempted to set up facilities of care for those displaced by the war. It was a necessary task, and I took great pleasure in helping those who'd been caught living too closely to the kobolds. But I was no warrior. I imagined that I would always bear the shame of my own shortcomings, held against my brother's fiercer nature, were it not for something my father said to me, less than a week before the dragon's final assault on the capital. "The people's needs are never so simple as they seem," he said, taking his favorite seat in the pavilion, built overlooking the koi pond. "Even I, with two hands such as these, could never hope to meet them all at once. My sons will not suffer with such difficulties. Your brother protects what land we have, while you provide for our subjects. Just as we cannot provide if the land is taken from us. So the protection becomes meaningless if you squander what gifts may be gleaned from it." My father had never been one to waste words on meaningless praise. He had never spoken to me thus before, and I sought to memorize his words even as I watched the multicolored fish swarming over and past one another like brightly colored veils. Orange and white, blue and gold. I had not returned to the pavilion since the assault on our city,
but it bolstered my spirit somewhat to know that the fish would remember our conversation. That though I could no longer ask my father for confirmation of his words, there was some creature left who had been witness to them. The women combed back what was left loose of my hair, leaving the warrior's braids to hang tight and wet over the left shoulder. That configuration meant I was still little more than a child. There was jade in my hair, jade pierced through my ears. Jade hung round my neck and clasped around my wrists. Yet it was white jade, for only the emperor could wear the green. I wondered at the sight my brother would present to the retainers of our house and to the 7 closest houses beneath us when he stepped out into the sunlight to greet the diplomats from Volstov. I wouldn't see him until they did. I hoped they would tremble at the sight, proud as our father would have been. I hoped they would feel shame, or at least the barest whisper of terror. Pride welled up in my heart, bitter and fiercely strong. Now that we were at peace, I no longer wore the robes of a warrior. Nevertheless, the crest of my father's house was woven into the fabric of my robes, the same as it was woven into the robes my brother wore. I could almost hear my father say, "This too is a warrior's duty." The servants fell away from me, all but one, who dropped to his knees and slid the door open. Kuje was waiting for me in the hall, bowing low so that I couldn't see his face. I didn't have to. "My lord," he said, "all is ready." It was then that we heard the sudden commotion from without. From where we were on the eastern side of the palace, just above the courtyard, the sound of the carriages arriving was harsh and jarring. Kuje did not even lift his head, and though the servants scattered, I held myself in place and checked my desire to run to the window and see them as they were. Invaders from a distant land, arriving under the colors of peace. My hands trembled. "My lord," Kuje said again. I straightened myself as my brother would have done. The trick, I knew, was to rein yourself in as you would a wild horse. A man had 2 hearts, one public and one private. The latter held all his truths, while the former was more easily steered and more easily broken. "The emperor is waiting," I said. "Come." Caius. We had already reached the Kihan Gardens, but still I had no idea who had decided that General Alcibiades should be among the delegation of peace to the capital. Presumably it must have been the Esar who made that choice, as he was the supreme ruler of all Volstov's subjects. But I had never known the Esar to exhibit even the slightest sense of humor. Such peculiar capriciousness simply wasn't his style. And while I was personally amused, I was also bewildered. This suggested that there must have been some other element in his decision-making process, which meant that Alcibiades had some hidden quality that did not become apparent, even when one shared a carriage with him from one capital city to another. So, as yet, I could see no reason beyond accident or my own good luck for such an unexpected anomaly to have occurred right here and in my carriage of all places. In short, I was delighted, although I suspected the other members of our party did not see eye to eye with me on the matter. There were 9 of us altogether, seemingly gathered from all corners of Volstov. Representing the magicians were myself, of course, alongside the charming Wildgrave Azan and Marceline, whom I'd met during our tiresome sojourn in the Basquiat. The 2 of us would have so much catching up to do. Since the last time we'd spoken, we'd both been somewhat under the weather. Alcibiades, I supposed, was part of some sort of misguided military representation that included two lieutenants whose names I hadn't bothered learning. They seemed like dreadfully boring sorts in any case. We had a scholar by the name of Marius, another survivor from our little study group at the Basquiat, and bringing up the rear were Margrave Gisette and our leader, Fiacre, who I could only assume were both here to represent good common sense. In order to somewhat soften the blow that the Kihan were the conquered nation and, I presumed, in order to avoid causing an international incident wherever possible, since most of us were quite sick of war, we had retired our more garish colours. None of us wore red, the Isar's royal colour, and favoured for generations among the court, except as subtle reminders, hints of satin lining perhaps, or the stripes on one general's regulation jacket. We did this to show respect, if not deference, for we had conquered the people across the kobolds despite how nearly they had come to conquering us. The Kihan much preferred the colour blue. Again, I was delighted, for blue suited my complexion much better than Volstov's overly assertive red. During my exile, I wore blue at every possible occasion, but one couldn't be so rash before the Isar himself. This diplomatic mission was my opportunity, therefore, to dress as I pleased, and I was one of many such peacocks trussed up in conciliatory colours, though thankfully I wasn't one of the awkward soldiers adjusting their tight collars or the red-faced magicians frowning out the windows of their carriages. Rather, I was dressed all in splendid midnight blue, though it was accented with the aforementioned discreet red lining, and I was thrilled to have the chance to dress so. Also, it appeared to be causing Alcibiades great displeasure, firstly because he was my lone carriage companion, and secondly, because he himself was dressed entirely in his red uniform. When first we'd met, weeks ago during that unpleasant period of quarantine in our own Basquiat, I admit I found him somewhat akin in colouring and in shagginess to the long-haired golden dogs that were favoured by the Esserina 100 years ago and could thus be found in every single portraiture of that period, slobbering over everything and looking wildly pleased with themselves. Alcibiades, however, never looked wildly pleased with himself or indeed with anything. In the carriage he simply looked wildly red. When I broached the subject with him, quite tactfully, I thought, I was met with something resembling a horse's snort and a brusque, "I'm Volstovic, not a bastion bloody Kihan." I liked the man already. It was at some point between Thremedon and Kihan land that I decided we would be friends, although I was yet uncertain how to make this equally obvious to Alcibiades himself. By the time we reached the Kihan gardens, which were both opulent and refined at once, nothing at all like the wildly overgrown greenhouses with their vibrant colours and abuse of perfectly good tulips that one is subject to in Thremedon, the strict formality of the place made me realise that there would hardly be any time for such diversions as friendship. The gardens flanked us on either side, deceptively tranquil. The palace itself rose before us, tiered roofs, dark blue and black, and, standing still as little statues, there were at least 50 retainers in the bleached white courtyard, stark and square and rather like a box. Their faces betrayed nothing. They might just as well have been statues, for all their eyes revealed. Our carriages erupted into their world with the stomping and whinnying of horses, the commotion of wheels on the sand, and the immediate chaos that began as 9 delegates from Volstov stepped out of their carriages all at once. Fiacre kept his composure best, stepping neatly from his conveyance only to turn right around and offer a hand to his carriage companion, Margrave Gisette. She declined the gesture, stepping down and stirring up a delicate cloud of white dust with the prim swish of her skirts. Next and nearest to us was Wildgrave Azan, who was busily adjusting the length of his sleeves as Marceline pursed her lips next to him, looking relatively unimpressed with the whole affair. Hello, my dear,
I murmured as an aside.
Greylace, she said, looking wary but nonetheless unsurprised.
On our other side were Lieutenants Casimiro and Valeri, their names coming to me in a fortuitous coincidence with Alcibiades' grunted greetings. They looked very uncomfortable in their new uniforms, especially Casimiro, the larger of the two. He kept glancing to one side at Alcibiades, as though to somehow divine the mystery of how he'd managed to wear his own reds across the border unscathed. Lastly, and quite alone, that fortunate creature, came Marius, a scholar at the Versity as well as a magician associated with the Basquiat. In fact, now that I counted our party, the numbers were overwhelmingly in the favor of magicians, myself included. This meant that the only men without talent were Casimiro and Valeri, though Alcibiades' talent was as good as non-existent for all he used it. What a curious group. We seemed more like a circus than Volstov's best, the soldiers looking like clowns and the magicians from the Basquiat are even more so. For a man as uncomfortable around magicians as the Isar was, he'd certainly chosen a great number of them to represent his interests. Or perhaps he merely considered us expendable, should any trouble arise. And amidst the chaos, there was Alcibiades, a bright red thumb in the noonday heat. I drew up close to him, the silk of my blue jacket, cut especially after the Kihan style, rustling about me. One of these men is rather unlike the rest, I murmured, taking his arm. He stiffened as if I had just produced a dead mouse from his pocket. His eyes were alert, and I decided then that he must be far more intelligent than the fashionably long-haired golden dog that I too had once owned as a pet, to see what all the fuss was about. Though her eyes had been very kind, they had never once been what any man might label alert. All the same to me, he muttered in an undertone which was more of a reply than I'd got to many of my observations during the long carriage ride. I felt especially heartened. He was alert, but not particularly perceptive then, for there were certainly differences in the men ranged before us, close together as though in defensive battle formation. Surely it wouldn't be prudent to spend all my time among the Kihan, thinking in terms of our warring past, though, and I dismissed the thought as swiftly as it had come. Our men and women of Volstov began to arrange themselves close as well, as though they'd been prodded into a showing of proper etiquette by the Kihan delegation arrayed before us. We didn't manage to stand nearly as straight or as still as they did, though. We'd been counseled before coming over by three separate professors from the Versity, no less, that the culture of the Kihan was one deeply fixed in ceremony, and that our most royal presence, the Isar, would be vastly disappointed if any of our number derailed the course of diplomacy simply by erring in decorum. Subsequently, our preparation for the journey had included an intensive course in ceremony, which I had thoroughly enjoyed. There was a certain grace and purpose of reason about all their cold and calm rules that I found quite fascinating. It was a shame I'd found no one to share my enthusiasm with, but that would soon change once I'd brought Alcibiades around. It would be more difficult, perhaps, than training a dog, but then I was accustomed to such challenges. One of the Kihan diplomats stepped forward, not the one I'd singled out, but the one standing just over his shoulder. He wore his hair tied back in the thick braided style of their generals, though I hadn't had the proper time to study the significance of each plait. Indeed, it was a shame my own hair was not quite long enough yet to adopt a similar style, for I thought myself rather in need of such a change, and surely it would be a most flattering display of solidarity. The diplomat clasped his hands and bowed low to our arrival party. Unlike our own clothing in varying patterns of the same shade, the men of the Kihan were dressed in many different colors, with seemingly no rhyme or reason. Each
however, wore a sash of midnight blue that denoted their patriot status in what I felt was a very tasteful and stylish display. Perhaps I could speak with Alcibiades about doing the same, though perhaps that conversation would be better saved for later, once I had discerned the best possible way of phrasing it. I could be quite convincing when I put my mind to it.
Welcome,
said the diplomat, speaking as though he could not quite wrap his tongue around our thick Volstovic vowels. The Kihan language was quick and darting, quite musical and lovely in its own way. But it was on conqueror's terms that we had come. And even on foreign soil, it was to be our men who dictated the terms of the treaty. I was a Velikaya, and even though my talent lay in creating visions and not reading minds, I could still sense the animosity behind each impassive face.
We have prepared rooms for your arrival, the diplomat continued,
slow but certain of his wording.
Shortly we will dine, then begin our talks.
Some of the men seemed surprised at this, though I myself was only too grateful not to be leaping headfirst from carriage to conference without even so much as a hot bath in between. Whatever could be said of the Kihan, and I was certain I'd heard the bulk of it in recent years, their hospitality was a marvellous thing. At my side, Alcibiades snorted, though whether it was out of some specific affront or the burden of having to bear any length of time among the Kihan, I couldn't say. Knowing him only as well as I did, though, I could imagine that he'd been eager to dive into the talks straight away. Perhaps his ideal would be for us to have been finished by nightfall. Though among our number there were a great many men who enjoyed the sound of their own voices a little too much for that to be a possibility. The diplomat clapped his hands, and into the courtyard filed a line of men and women in robes the color of ripe persimmon. They bore lanterns and kept their eyes averted to the floor. Like the diplomats, they maintained a stony silence of expression that I would have admired were it not for the creeping loneliness of the thing. Surely, outside the confines of diplomacy, it would not be amiss upon occasion to express a human emotion. And I would have said as much to Alcibiades if, for a moment, I thought he might appreciate the irony in my words. We were going to have such high times, he and I.
Alcibiades. There were 17 ways to bow to a Kihan statesman, and I didn't know a single one of them. Which, by my way of thinking, was just fine, because I wasn't bowing to any Kihan statesman or no. The Aesir had his reasons for sending me along with the rest of the diplomats, no doubt because I knew Kihan ground pretty well, and I suppose I was there as backup in case a sticky situation got stickier, and there wasn't anything to do about it besides reach for the sword. I guessed it was also to do with my talent, more like a disease to my thinking. But there wasn't really much I could do about it now. The Aesir said that it was more likely to be useful than not, having a magician no one knew about in along with the rest of the diplomats. And I couldn't exactly argue with him on that, much as I hated thinking of myself as a magician. There were enough of those already, and I didn't exactly see how sending me was a big secret when more than half the people along with us had been stuck in the basket right alongside me during the magician's plague. Caius Greylace, Marcy and Marius had even been in on the little group we'd put together to try and figure it all out, before Margrave Royston's child bride farm boy had gone and done it for us, that was. Anyway, point was, it was no big secret that I had a talent, except to the Kihan. And I guess that was probably the point. There were other military men there besides me, at least. Lieutenants Casimiro and Valerio had somehow got roped into this sorry state of affairs the same as I had. Casimiro was a big fellow who talked too much, and Valeri was a little man who didn't talk, ever. But we respected each other well enough to stay out of each other's hair, and that was good enough for me. That didn't mean I had to like this arrangement, though. It was uncomfortable days of riding in a carriage to come to a place I didn't want to set foot in, to put on a smile I didn't want to wear on my face,
and about a man who'd just as soon have cut me down if everything had worked out a little differently. It was too short a period of time to go forgiving an entire country for fighting so underhanded that they almost won. There were some tactics you never forgave. I didn't like their blank expressions, or the way their women hopped too quick as soldiers might have, just to serve the enemy. That was the sort of behaviour that made a man wonder what the women he knew back home would have done if the coin had fallen to the other side. Everyone in the Keyhan Palace was too fucking polite. At least I hadn't slapped on enemy colours just to keep them happy. I could feel every last one of them staring at me, but I wasn't playing any games or crawling into bed with an enemy I'd only just got the better of. This was Volstov's victory. It was bad enough being sent there to hammer out the terms of a more lasting treaty. I didn't have to make it worse by dressing like them and pretending I didn't hate it just as much as they did. Their whole palace was a tricky affair designed to be treacherous, its narrow hallways winding around each other like the individual threads of a spider's web, and its walls made of paper so thin you could see shadows passing before them in the rooms hidden just on the other side. Whispers chased us when we got too close, and now and then the sound of a woman's ghostly laughter followed close behind. On top of that, with all of us feeling like exhibits at the zoo, there were mirrors, slanted against the ceiling, fitted into every corner where simple lamps should have been. Any sort of light you wanted came from your own personal tight-mouthed, Keyhan grovelling bastard, who followed you around like he'd stab you in the back as soon as light the way for you. We were esteemed guests, all right. So esteemed, we wouldn't be able to go anywhere or do anything without having someone watching us. Well, I told myself, if they wanted to assign some poor fool the job of listening to me snore and being privy to when and where and how much I shat, that was fine by me. Chances were it'd be worse for him than it would be for me. It was a waste of everyone's time, and I wasn't bothering myself any by thinking about it. "Do you know," said Caius Greylace, coming up on me unannounced like some kind of winter ailment, "that the mirrors show you everything happening all along the halls? How clever." I wasn't in the mood to praise Keyhan ingenuity like some fat country noble might praise his favourite spaniel. Chances were this Caius creature would get bored soon enough and find someone else to bother. It didn't matter who, so long as it wasn't me. I didn't like spaniels. "Looks like," I said.
"I suppose they must have an awful lot of trouble with assassination,"
Caius went on. He was dressed half like a woman and half like a lunatic, breezing through the halls behind our lamp-bearer, the fabric of whatever it was he was wearing swishing all the way.
"Or perhaps they're simply inbred. I hear it causes paranoia in noble bloodlines as old and as carefully guarded as theirs."
I didn't say anything to that at all. We were all split up by where we slept, a fact I didn't enjoy for a second. And I would have made it clear at the time I realised it too if Caius hadn't exclaimed over a peacock wandering across the courtyard, effectively ending all conversation on the matter of lodgings. What really set all the warning bells off in my head was the way we were put here and there, and most of us halfway across the palace from one another, with real careful regard paid to status and nothing else. Gisette Fiacre and Wildgrave Azam were all quartered together in the west wing of the palace, for example, whereas Cassie and Val were somewhere in the south, nearer to the stables and the menagerie. I hadn't even seen Marcy and Marius since we'd arrived, which tickled me the wrong way. I didn't like a second of it. I didn't like it especially because the whole east wing of the palace, which was where I'd be spending Bastion only knew how much time, stank of some particular incense that burned my throat and my eyes. It was real distracting, and I didn't doubt that they were doing it on purpose. Keyhan was made up of tricky bastards.
"In any case,"
Caius continued, moving neatly around a corner, then pausing to wait for me to join him,
"I believe we're staying above the Eastern Gardens. Is it the Eastern Gardens? The peacock certainly was a distraction. I wonder if we can have one brought in especially for entertainment. They're very rare, but I would so like a closer look.
Heard the Keon eat them, I ground out. The servant leading us paused for a moment, but it was only because we'd fallen behind and it was his duty to wait for us. I picked up my pace, and this time it was Caius who hurried to keep alongside me, rustling all the way.
Eat peacocks? He asked.
One of his eyes was queerly discoloured, and being looked at by him felt like you were having a conversation with two different people, and both of them equally insane. Right, I said. Eat peacocks. I'd heard the rumours about Caius Greylace, the same as any. Kept as the Esau's pet lapdog practically since birth, for his talent in visions, and his lack of qualms about using them to get information. He tortured anyone who possessed information, and quite a few people who didn't, if the rumours were anything to go by. Then, because he was young and wild, he went after some other poor bastard at court. The reason changed, depending on who you asked, but the result was always the same, and drove him mad, without blinking an eye. Well, not even the Esau could overlook that sort of thing, so he was banished quicker than a flash. Exiled at 14, and not brought back until 3 years later, when everyone had been recalled for the final push. Just before we'd all gone and got slammed by that blasted plague. He didn't look so mad as they made him out to be, though. In fact, he just looked small and very pale, with an odd habit of pursing his lips between sentences. But I set no store by appearances. They didn't mean as much as the deeds a man did. His were a little queerer than most, but then we'd all done worse than we might have wanted during the war.
I doubt that's true, Caius rallied swiftly, adjusting one of his sleeves. I believe you're being truculent.
The servant stopped a second time, saving me from having to make any kind of reply, and hooked the lamp in a sconce by another of the Keyhorn's many useless paper square doors. They didn't have any locks, and for the servant to let us in, he had to go through a complicated dance of kneeling, sliding the door open and finishing off, for no reason I could see, by bowing so low his forehead was pressed to the ground. The whole thing made me uncomfortable. Caius, on the other hand, seemed right at home. I guessed it had something to do with how he was used to being exiled. And maybe being sent to nanny a conquered nation was a step up from where he'd been last time. It wasn't my place to judge. The servant didn't budge.
Well, Caius said, either they have grossly underestimated our number or we're in the same room.
Maybe he's waiting for us to do something, I replied. There was no telling if the servant spoke our language or not, and I was pretty sure neither of us spoke his. Chances were we could stand there all night doing nothing while he got intimate with the floor or maybe started kissing our boots for good measure. And I'd never get my chance to sit alone for even a fucking minute. Just piecing things together inside my own head and figuring out how it was I'd landed here when all I'd wanted was to go home. The war was over, but I was still surrounded by Keon. The world was too funny like that sometimes. Only I couldn't see my way toward laughing along with it. Ridiculous, I snapped, and reached for the lamp myself. The servant looked up as if to protest, but then scrambled quickly away, bowing his head like his life depended on it. Maybe it did, I didn't know. The lamp, even though it looked light enough for something made out of rice paper, was surprisingly heavy, but not half so heavy as a Volstov blade. I thrust it inside the room, which lit up bright as day. Everything. The strange flat bed, the canopy hung above it from the ceiling, the short tables, the pillows, the screen standing in the far corner, was some shade or another of blue. Next to me, Caius began to laugh, a gentle, curious sound that reminded me of the whispers that had followed us all the way here.
Yours must be the next room over, he said. And what is that lovely scent?
Nothing was going to get done if we kept at it, bandying words around like we were already in talks with the statesmen themselves. From the direction the servant was bowing and scraping in, it seemed as though Caius had guessed right about where my rooms were. Without saying anything about the incense, which was like as not going to turn my eyes as red as my coat by morning and do worse to my throat, I got inside my own quarters, slid the door shut hard, and wished a bastion I was anywhere but where I was. At least my room wasn't so much blue as it was turquoise green. But I got the picture clear enough. I was alone, finally, so I could unbutton my collar, and there were lamps in the room at least, thank bastion, which were tricky, dangling oil and wick affairs that took some coaxing to get themselves lit. But they weren't going to get the best of me, not when I'd lit fires out of less and trickier besides. I've got a couple of them going, shadows dancing across the walls whenever I moved this way or that. Mostly it was just dark, because apparently the Keyhan, with all their inventing, hadn't seen fit to invent windows. Maybe they just didn't like looking out at their ruined city. For that I didn't blame them. In the next room over I could hear the sound of water being run. There were some men who couldn't stand even a little grit on their skin, and I guessed that Caius Greylace was one of those. I didn't think there was much time for a bath, and I didn't much want to wrestle with the tub either, which was round and half set into the floor and hidden by a standing screen. Nope, as far as I could see, there was nothing for it but to wait. Unfortunately, there wasn't anywhere to sit. Just a few large seating pillows grouped together in the corners, and the bed, which wasn't more than a pallet as far as I could see, complete with the most bastion awful-looking pillow I'd ever seen. At least I thought it was a pillow. It might have been some weird Keyhan torture device. Whatever it was, I wasn't sleeping on it, and it was no more than a glorified slab of wood. No doubt royalty got a proper bed and pillow, but this was good enough for us Volstoviks. I was sure it was just their way of thumbing their noses at us, a good little dig at the victors. Sneaky all over, that was the key on for you. Well, I was going to ask for some proper chairs. Aside from that, there were the bath and the screen and a low, long table and desk, and then something I guessed had to be a chair for the lack of anything else it could be. It looked like a crescent moon, made all of black wood, polished so bright I thought for a minute it might have been metal. It didn't look like a room to live in. It looked more like a room for getting bowed to in. And if there was one feeling I'd learned to hate in the past few months, it was being bowed to. On top of all that, there was only the one door, which didn't settle my nerves any. Part of the wood on the wall that joined my room to Caius Greylace's looked different, so there might have been a sliding panel. And that was it. My things were coming up later, but I hadn't brought with me half as much as some of the others. To my way of thinking, this wasn't some holiday. It was business. The Esar's business. And I was there to serve him, not take in the sights or dress myself up like a game bird on the table. So maybe I was predisposed not to enjoy myself. But this was enemy territory, and would continue to be until we signed more than a few provisionary treaties about islands hundreds of miles from here and dragon parts that were barely more than scrap metal now. I was just about to break my chair down into something more comfortable when the strange panel of wood I'd noticed before slid open nice and smooth. The Keyhan kept their doors well oiled, which was something to note, in the service of a silence that got under my skin and stayed there. "What in bastion are you doing?" I demanded, ready to use my chair as a weapon. It was better suited for that, just the right amount of heavy, and fitted with sharp corners at the ends. "Are you going to hit me with that?" Caius Greylace, fresh out of a bath and smelling like roses, was standing in the open space. Light from behind him poured through into my dimly lit room, and steam too. I don't know whether to be flattered or terrified. I'll put the chair down. Is something the matter? Yes, Caius said. Something dire, something dreadful. Well? I've no idea what you're going to be wearing tonight. He went on smoothly, brushing damp, pale hair out of his eyes. Red, I snapped, eyeing him warily. Why in bastion do you want to know that? No, he said,
waving his hand about. Of course you'll be wearing red. I ascertained that earlier, in the carriage. I meant, what style of garment?
Style? I repeated.
He gave me a look like he thought I was the insane idiot of us two, which made me wonder if I hadn't been right in the first place when I was still thinking he was a Keyhan assassin.
I should have hit him with the chair.
Style, he said, of garment that you will be wearing tonight during the festivities in our honour. Are you suffering from some sort of post-war mental deficiency? I hear it plagues old soldiers, something dreadful.
I'm going to be wearing red, I repeated.
Are you going to be wearing that? He asked.
I figured he meant my jacket, which was fine as far as I could see, and I bristled.
Served me well enough during the war, I ground out. Yes, I'm sure it did, by the look of it, he said. Well, if you insist. I'm not entirely sure I have anything that will match even remotely, but I suppose I shall have to do the best I can under the circumstances.
Best you can, I said.
Under the circumstances, he concluded.
Right, I said, except we're matching. I was starting to realise that all the stories about Caius Greylace I'd heard from disreputable and reputable sources alike, about he was 17 different kinds of cracked, about how his parents are just as good as let wolves raise him,
about how you couldn't be near him without getting the queer feeling that you were riding the centre of some wild fucking storm, had been truths.
All of them. Mostly I got that from the way he was looking at me, all uneven, because of the unevenness of his eyes.
As if he could read my thoughts, and maybe he could. I didn't know much about that kind of thorny talent.
He pushed some hair over the bad eye, the left one, and set to examining his nails.
Of course we're matching, he said. If we're to arrive together.
This isn't Dolls and Houses, I muttered.
Oh, no, he said,
offering me a sharp-toothed smile.
It's so much better.
Kuje. I was a boy when my own father died, younger than either of the princes, but better prepared, since his had been a long-fought battle with illness. Before his condition worsened, he often took me to the river while my mother slept, her face grown thin and weary with caring for him. He towered over me then and forever, since I never had the years in which to grow and surpass him.
Look, Kuje,
he said to me, one large hand placed against my shoulder, his voice ragged with the cough that had taken root in his chest.
See how the river flows ever onward, pouring all it has into the distant great ocean?
I was still young and more interested in the sunburnt autumn leaves or the toy boats bobbing cheerfully in the current. Nevertheless, I loved my father. What was more, it was my duty to listen when he spoke.
Our family has served the emperor for countless proud years, he continued.
There was more grey than black in his beard, though his hair remained dark as ever,
his jaw cut sharp and proud. When I am gone, you will be sworn to his youngest son.
My father always looked out at the river, never at me. I had not understood then, as I came to in later years, that my father's message to me was a gift. In his own way, he tried to tell me that the best servant is as the river, patiently giving over everything in its body to the greater ocean. After some time, I came to understand that it was not a simple man's will that governed this balance, but nature itself. It was thus my duty and my nature to watch over Mamoru, the youngest prince, and serve our great emperor in this fashion. I did this to the best of my abilities, since the day my lord Mamoru was born, 25 years ago. At the time, I was no more than 7,
Then?
Sudden and violent as all things in war, matters changed. It was not a cataclysmic change, though many would have argued the fact. When the emperor took his own life for honor, it was a subtler change, like a shifting of weight that came over the palace where before everything had been well balanced. Our Lord Isul was, of course, the rightful heir to his father's legacy, and any man with an eye for strategy could see that it was perhaps not the worst time for him to ascend the throne. For despite our losses at the hands of the Volstov, the eldest prince had gained much respect among the people for his cunning as a general of war. If anyone could lift us from the depths of our shame and defeat, it would surely be the emperor's firstborn son, who was now emperor himself. Isul was young enough yet to begin his own era, but old enough to have been tested as a warlord and found capable. It was a better chance at rebuilding than any one man among the Kihan could have hoped for. It had shattered my prince to lose his father in ways that it had not shattered Isul. But then, that was only to be expected. Of the two, Mamoru was the more tender. Ready enough, Mamoru said from the depths of his room, if not prepared. My lord, I said, bowing low. It was a game we often played before parties or banquets, though it was habit this time and not youthful nervousness which compelled the exchange. The jade ornaments in my lord Mamoru's hair clacked softly against one another as he stepped past me, the sound of them almost hidden in the hustle and bustle of servants rushing up and down the hall, gossiping with one another over the distant, uncultured thud of foreign boots. It seemed strange to imagine that, not so long ago, the sound would have signaled the approach of enemy troops. Perhaps the lords in charge of talks would remember that, and tactfully request that the diplomats remove their shoes. Their doing so wasn't entirely likely. The lords charged with governing the talks had been chosen specifically for their absence from the war itself. As I understood it, they were for the most part courtiers, men who hadn't seen enough to personalize the conflict, and so could approach peace with a clear head. I envied them their clear heads, just as I envied them their untroubled sleep. They would not reach for their weapons at night when they heard the tremor of heavy leather boots against the floor. The prince paused at a junction in the hall. Perhaps he too was ill at ease among the new flurries of activity everywhere one turned. A servant was not meant to make noise where he or she walked. But with the early arrival of the diplomats from Volstov, many of them had succumbed to near panic and allowed their footfalls to sound heavily against the floor, without care for who heard their comings and goings. There was to be an audience that night between the diplomats and our esteemed Emperor Isul, as well as the seven houses that held a place of honor beneath his crest. Preceding that, there would be a dinner in the Emperor's own dining hall.
If things had been different, the death of an emperor, so fierce a warrior, so proud a man, would have disallowed feasting in all forms, and only plain rice would have been eaten, so as not to offend the gods with excess while mourning.
Things, however, were as they were. No small river could change them. I had my own interest, carefully concealed, in whether or not the men from Volstov would be able to stomach an exchange of hospitalities with our men, or whether our generals would be the first to break. Certainly, there were men of the seven houses who did not have so much to lose as I had by speaking out against this occupation, however prettily clothed it came. We came to the back entrance of the dining hall, placed specifically for those others sitting at the high table, so that no man but the Emperor himself would draw attention by crossing the room to the dais at the back. That was where Mamoru settled himself, between Lord Timur of the Western Prefecture and the throne once reserved for his father. Mamoru's place was at the Emperor's right hand, just as it had been Isul's place before him. The men and women from Volstov sat at the lower tables in groups, as moths huddled around the reassurance of a flame. Some were dressed in the Volstovic style, but wore the Kihan shade of blue. Some show of deference, I supposed. We had a history between us of talks for peace, thwarted by things so simple and yet so fundamental as the color of our clothes. Others wore a style of clothing more similar to our own, but the similarity was undone by their broad, expressive faces and the nervous way they glanced about, as though expecting an ambush at any moment. A man with hair the color of dried wheat laughed too loudly. Kuje. Mamoru lowered his voice, beckoning me to bend my head. My lord. The doors at the front of the room opened, and Mamoru tightened his posture with the precision of a musician tuning a lute. Three of Isul's retainers preceded him into the dining hall, their clothing the plain dark brown robes that denoted their status as distinguished servants. The four men behind him, clad in green, were the Emperor's own vassals, trained as warriors to protect their lord at any cost. Their faces, clean-shaven and hard, betrayed nothing. They were the men that the former Emperor had trusted most in all the land. It would be for Isul to decide whether or not to retain them, or to replace them with men he trusted more. They should not have been dressed so colorfully, but the honorable dead had been forgotten in favor of the honorable future. The newly anointed emperor himself wore ornaments of green jade threaded through his many warrior braids. There were rings, perfect smooth circles for victories past, and sharply curved pieces that resembled a fierce predator's teeth. Pins that formed the shape of a dragon, a catfish, a maple leaf. On his wrists, he wore dozens of deep green bracelets and heavy strands of stone beads around his neck. His robes were embroidered in green and gold with the symbols for strength and for power. Signs the emissaries from Volstov would not be able to interpret explicitly, but which they would sense by his comportment, his posture, the very tilt of his chin. Over his heart was his father's crest, which was now his own. The fabric beneath the needlework burned a deep, rich red. Not the vulgar, glaring red of our Volstovic guests, but the color of a good wine, or the blood that flowed from a too deep cut. Everyone at the high table bowed as one, their foreheads scraping their plates. The diplomats from Volstov moved to stand, as was no doubt their poor way of recognizing a king of kings, before they too hung their heads in ungraceful bows. They numbered 9, men of all sizes and 2 women, an unorthodox practice among our own people. Some were clearly soldiers, brawling men built for a good fight, while others were clearly scholars. Men who had no doubt been recruited for their knowledge. There was even one who could not have been long past his boyhood, pale as the koi my lord favored so highly, and dressed up like a peacock. Isul's face was blank as he took his seat, his eyes as cold and as dark as flint rock. his poison taster sat down at his side, just behind the Lord Maedar from the southernmost prefecture. Our new emperor looked every bit the part, and I could feel my Lord Mamoru's pride in him. It was as evident as if he'd spoken it aloud. There was no reason for the shade that rose like a mist over my heart. There was no reason why I should not have felt the same pride in my new ruler, and even a kind of gladness for this day, when we could still perform our customs with pride in the face of our enemy's occupation. The shade was there, though, and I could do nothing but push it aside with the experience born of long practice. Things were not as they should be. My father, even weakened by illness as he was, would still have summoned the will to refuse to dine under such an inauspicious roof. I sat at Mamoru's right, just behind him, that I might better taste the food as it came, and before it reached my lord's own lips. I had only been poisoned this way once before, by enemies of the Emperor's house. It had caused a dreadful fever in my blood, rendering me unfit for duty over a long and torturous period of weeks. In the end, it was nearly a month. Such an experience, however, was made worthwhile when I considered how I had done my duty for my lord, and how Mamoru had been spared the suffering. The rice came first, and there was no taste of any malevolence to mar its clean flavor. I passed it up to the table. Mamoru nodded his thanks, the gesture curt and mannered. The men from Volstov were staring up at the high table still, their mouths open in awe, as though in all their years since birth, they'd never learned to close them. If they were waiting for the Emperor to make a speech, they would be waiting a long time. Custom dictated that discussions of politics were to be had only after a proper dinner. Fire could be lit in an empty belly. In a full one, there was no room for it. Isul seated himself with a rustling of fabric, his taster at his left, so that no man would come between him and his brother. It was important now more than ever to make a show of unshakable unity. If pressed to the point of a sword, I might have admitted that my unease did not subside throughout the course of the meal. Rather, it remained fixed firmly in my mind, impossible to ignore, like the weight in the air before a lightning storm. I had grown up alongside Isul. I had never been assigned to his service, but we were nearly peers in age, and as such I had been privy to his growth into a man, simply because I had been doing the same thing at the same time. As such, I could recall an incident with Volstovic prisoners of war, taken captive when my lord Mamoru had been just shy of 4, and I myself had been 11. I was allowed into the great reception hall for the first time that year, while my lord took his afternoon nap, his condition being particularly delicate in his earlier years. And it was there that I first saw the elder prince in full regalia, dressed every inch like the heir to the empire, and seated beside the emperor himself with the gravest of expressions on his face.
"It is for my son to decide their fates," the emperor had said, "for soon enough, every decision for the well-being of this country will be his. And how else might he learn than through practice?"
The 7 warlords had nodded their assent, any mistrust carefully hidden beneath their courtly masks. How could a child be trusted, after all, to understand the gravity of their situation? The young prince had raised his head, eyes sharp and lined with kohl. Have them killed, he said. The chance for escape is too great. We fight Volstov from outside our borders, and we cannot afford to fight them from within as well. I could not have read any of the expressions in the room, even if I'd tried. The experienced members of court had all been trained since birth to keep everything to themselves. And as someone relatively new to palace life, I could not hope to breach those barriers. Yet I was still experienced enough to perceive that his decision had been an unexpected one. No one, of course, expected a child to have such capacity for ruthlessness. Isul proved himself to be a man filled with surprises from a very young age. It was an impression I have never forgotten since. The first indication of his capabilities, but certainly not the last. Soup came after the rice, then the fish course. All were untampered with. In my time at the palace, and with the war's end, it was my charge to look after the Prince Mamoru, to taste his food for poison, and to guard his person from those who would wish him ill. If I could only perform my duty well enough to take in the poison before it reached my lord, in whatever form it came, I could consider my life well spent.
Chapter 2 Alcibiades. According to Caius Greylace, it wasn't a show of solidarity or support for Volstov that the new emperor had this big red spot on his robes. But that didn't stop me from feeling better about how eager everyone was to turn colours. I was the only man wearing red at the dinner, save for the emperor and Caius, who was wearing what looked like some kind of red bow in his hair. It's a local hair ornament, Caius said. To my way of thinking, though, he looked too much like one of those stuffed bears you win for your childhood sweetheart at the fair. But I had to admit, out of everyone who was trying to affect the Keyhorn style of dress and failing, Caius Greylace was the only one who didn't look like a giant ass-backwards fool. So that might have been one reason why the crazy little snake had been added to this mission in the first place. Other than that, the new emperor's way of dealing with us was not to talk at all for the first half hour of the meal, as though he thought he could make us crack just by sitting up straight as a rod, with all eyes on him, taking his food from his poison taster and eating it like he was king of the world and not, in fact, the emperor of a conquered country. Isn't the young prince nice looking, though? Caius murmured at my left, putting a hand on my elbow and almost making me drop my bowl of half-cooked food. It wouldn't have made much difference. I didn't have a poison taster and I wasn't eating it. I gave Greylace a look that put across all my disgust. He cooed happily like a pigeon. It's remarkable they're brothers, that's all I mean. Caius murmured demurely. It was a whisper so quiet I didn't even know how I heard it. I hadn't even noticed another prince. I knew there was one, of course, since before we'd left the country some versity experts had tried their best to teach us which end was up, by drawing us all a helpful little chart of the hierarchy in the Keyhorn. The emperor was at the top, of course, and his two sons below him. Beneath them were seven lords that, for whatever reason, he favoured more than the rest. I didn't have to know the whys of it, just who I was supposed to bow lowest to. Of course, the emperor had seen fit to off himself, which put us in quite the situation, arriving so awkwardly on the very day of his death. The Keyhorn didn't seem to hold that against us, at least not yet. The man Greylace was indicating sat just as straight as his brother, with white stone jewellery in his hair and around his throat. Maybe if the Keyhorn had spent a little less time dressing themselves in the morning and a little more time planning out their strategies, we wouldn't have won the war. Never mind the fact, of course, that they'd been tricky enough to see that we nearly lost. Anyway, next to the Emperor, the younger prince looked like a pale ghost. Since I wasn't eating, and since Caius didn't seem at all inclined toward leaving me in peace until I answered his question, I thought about what he'd said. The younger prince's face seemed more expressive than the Emperor's did, that was for certain. He looked more like a person, and less like the stern-eyed statues we'd seen standing in the outer gardens. "He's smaller," I said, since I couldn't say half of what I wanted, that he looked less full of himself too. Such things went against the spirit of diplomacy. And who knew who was listening and for what purpose? "Are you eating that?" Caius wanted to know, gesturing toward my plate. "It has the most divine flavour. It looks like..." I stopped myself part way, poking at the bowl with one of the little sticks they'd given us to eat with. They were dainty and delicate and slippery, and I'd managed to snap the other one in half earlier. I was half expecting my meal to poke back, but it just sat there, soggy, like it didn't care one way or another whether I ate it, which was pretty much in line with what I'd learned about the Keyhorn so far. "Well, I'm full anyway."
"Then you won't mind if I help myself," Caius reasoned,
merrily plucking away whatever pale uncooked thing had landed in my bowl to begin with. The unofficial leader of our merry band, a man by the name of Fiacra, had told us all beforehand that anything we didn't recognise was most likely fish, but I wasn't taking any chances. I guessed he was of a more diplomatic nature than I was, though, since at the table just next to ours he was eating everything off his plate and chatting to Wildgraver Zan about something that had happened on the way over. Next to him, Gisette and Marcy were having some kind of tete-a-tete over something that had 8 wriggly legs. There was some luck in the world, after all. That creature hadn't landed on my plate. It seemed to me that any man among the Keyhorn wouldn't be too broken up over the loss of a diplomat, however mysterious the cause of death. Dinner, endless, uncomfortable and quiet, since no man dared to say anything so long as the Emperor wasn't talking, ended with a funny moss-coloured dessert that Caius Greylace insisted was melon-flavoured gelatin. My stomach, meanwhile, was growling like one of our long-lost dragons. After the plates were cleared, the man who'd stood out to greet us held up his hand for attention. I guessed he'd been assigned the unhappy position of herding us diplomats until further notice. I wondered what he'd done to piss off the Emperor getting stuck with a job like that.
"There will be a short recess after dinner for our most esteemed emperor to prepare himself for the talks," the shepherd said.
Greylace leaned away from me to murmur something to Marceline about hiding silverware in their napkins to prepare for an ambush. It wasn't my type of humour, but at least it made me feel a little better about being so suspicious of the Keyhorn Emperor's good intentions. If there had been silverware, I might have even gone for that sort of thing myself, even though I didn't have the talent Marcy did. She could command metal like a breeder gave orders to his pups. It was a beautiful thing to behold in wartime, but that was neither here nor there. I didn't know what we needed with magicians at all, now that the war was over, but I wasn't the sort of man chosen to make decisions. It was the soldier in me, bred in too early and nothing to be done about it now but to follow orders. Maybe I'd be able to scare up some food during this recess. My growling stomach bode ill for any peacocks I might run across in the courtyards. Caius Greylace slipped his arm through mine as we stood up and I nearly flipped him over the table. "You've got to stop doing that," I told him. He laughed. The infuriating little snake. It was a high and tinkling laugh that reminded me that he'd been a member of the SARS Corp back at home and I hadn't. Of course, all that nobility amounted to a hill of beans when we'd both been sent packing to Xi'an. And at least common blood like mine didn't stoop to marrying first cousins or closer. Do you think we'll have time to change before the talks? Although I'd hate to exhaust my wardrobe on the first night, only to be caught wanting later on. Caius touched the bow in his ear fondly, chattering on without much care as to whether or not I was listening. I don't know, I said. Depends on how long it takes the Emperor to ready himself, whatever that shit means. Do you think he'll be changing? Oh, no, Caius said, and he looked so certain that I believed him immediately. That's traditional dress for the evening. He won't be changing out of it. Do you know, I heard that, according to custom, the Kihan should still be in mourning for their emperor. Only we've arrived early and forced them to speed along their proceedings. They're a marvellously adaptable people, don't you think? I could think of a few words I had for the ritual-obsessed Kihan, and adaptable wasn't one of them. I grunted just to show I'd heard him. No, you're right, I don't think I'll change, Caius said. At least not until I've spoken to their tailors. I'm assuming most of the men are wearing green and not blue because they don't want to offend anyone. He finished this with a pointed look at my army jacket. Fuck him, I thought. Little Rat didn't know what it meant to be a soldier, and I wasn't about to sweep all that I knew the Kihan were capable of under the carpet just yet. I adjusted my collar, which wasn't too tight, and took stock of my surroundings. There weren't any windows in the place since it was right in the middle of the palace and surrounded on all sides by the narrow halls. No good for making a quick exit, should the talks turn sour. It felt like being boxed in, like the tunnels in the kobolds had been modelled after the palace itself. As far as the Kihan were concerned, there wasn't a friendly face to be found in the crowd. In fact, there wasn't a face at all in the crowd that didn't wear a mask of stony indifference, save for one. And that was what surprised me. It was the younger prince himself. Things were pretty awkward, I'll give them that, but that was to be expected. Except that Fiacra and another member of the Basker, Gisette, seemed to be drawn to the younger prince like a horse to the feed. And when I looked over in their direction, they were actually talking to him. Gisette was laughing. I shot a glance at Lieutenant Valeri, who himself was looking pretty annoyed and pained by Casimiro, who'd somehow snagged himself a conversation with one of the bowing, scraping servants. He'd caught this one mid-scrape, and she had her head down like she wanted to plan an escape but couldn't decide whether or not she'd be breaching etiquette. Damn. Talking to Casimiro was bad enough when you understood the language. I couldn't help but think it'd be worse if you were a foreigner. Marius stood leaning up against the wall and speaking in low tones with Wild Grave Azan. They were both observing Fiacra's discussion with the prince with interest, but also like they were too smart to go over there and get in the line of fire themselves. The younger prince was flanked by a man who looked as put out by this whole situation as I was. I couldn't tell how unhappy he was from his face, but from the set of his shoulders. He was a soldier. And there was something resigned and tense in the way he held himself, like he thought he was going to be attacked too. Now that's hardly fair, Caius said, almost like he was getting ready to sulk. I thought it was the height of rudeness to go up and talk to a member of the royal family. Just the elder prince, I replied distractedly. It was obvious, at least to me, that while the Emperor was maintaining his mystique or whatever it was he thought he was going to accomplish with this recess, he'd left things up to his more personable younger brother, who was probably making polite conversation about the weather and the price of silk with two of our most esteemed diplomats. From the looks of the Emperor, from what kind of man he obviously was, it was likely a good thing, I thought, that he wasn't in the room to see how nicely his younger brother got on with the men and women from Volstov. Come, Caius said without any warning, giving my arm a fierce tug. I almost flipped him again, That time it was harder to squash the instinct. It wouldn't do to make a scene. And the last thing I wanted was to give Thesar any more reason than he already had to exile me. Not that a diplomatic mission was exiled, but it might as well have been. And after it was over, I was looking forward to a good long rest back home. I didn't need to give anyone any reason to be pissed off with me. After all, I'd only just got back from the front lines to find myself in the thick of it once more. Somehow or another, I'd managed to piss somebody off. Killing a member of the Bashkar in front of all the Kion warriors in the middle of treaty talks, no matter how much I wanted to or how easy it would have been, wouldn't look nice on my resume. So I managed not to kill Caius Greylace. But barely.
We simply have to talk to him, don't you agree? Caius asked. And for an incredibly small creature, I had to admit he was also incredibly strong.
He made good use of his size too, squeezing up next to Gisette as though he'd been there all along. The man flanking the prince narrowed his eyes, like maybe he was thinking about flipping Caius Greylace over if he got any closer. He was a bodyguard then, or whatever the Kian equivalent of that was. His hair was all thick black braids, pulled back into a complicated twist that left them to spill neat as you please down his back. Though unlike the Emperor, he didn't have any fancy jade dangles to make noise when he moved. Didn't matter, though, since from what I'd learned, it was the braids that were important. Something like our version of Medals of Honor. The man, whoever he was, had been a soldier. I thought it would have been pretty fucking hilarious if we'd recognised one another. But the truth was that all the Kion looked the same to me. And this poor bastard was probably thinking the exact same thing about us.
I am very pleased to hear you enjoyed the dinner,
the smiling prince said, his words softened and masked by a heavy accent.
Still, there was something about the way he looked so delighted to be speaking our language that you couldn't help feeling a little of it too. Oh, the dessert was especially wonderful,
Gisette told him,
and so light. I expect I'll have to be refitted for all my dresses by the time we leave.
The prince laughed politely like he'd understood maybe half of what Gisette had said, or at least enough to know that it was a pleasantry.
Who intends to leave? Caius asked. You put us so to shame with your hospitality, I've half a mind to stay here indefinitely once the talks are over. The prince trained his eyes on us, uncertain for a moment while he tried to sort out the words.
I thought about that glimpse we'd got of the Emperor, his brother, as compared to the lamb in front of us, lips moving silently like he was reading a book. He looked more like a foreign versity student than a prince. His brother, on the other hand, had looked every inch like haughty royalty. Maybe it skipped the second born.
Thank you,
the prince said carefully.
It is our hope that you feel comfortable here.
Caius ducked in a deep and graceful bow.
I'm Caius Greylace.
He elbowed me in the stomach, just above the hip, which I guessed meant I was supposed to bow too. Didn't mean I wasn't going to get him for it later, though.
This is my companion. He went on like we were there together or something.
Alcibiades, I said gruffly, because it was too late in the day to be getting into titles, and besides, I didn't have one. The prince nodded, taking in the latest display of prostration on my part with clever dark eyes. I didn't trust him, not for a minute. But then he had fewer braids in his hair than the man who stood beside him. He was more a prince than a warrior yet. This is Prince Mamaru, Fiacra said, looking pleased to have something to say. Haven't managed to catch the name of his stalwart companion yet, but he seems very tall. Prince Mamaru's eyes lit up with happiness, probably recognizing his name in among all our messy foreign words.
Mamaru, he said, resting a hand against his chest.
He was delicate enough that he reminded me a little of Greylace, though he was certainly quieter and heaps more reserved. So a Greylace I would have better liked to have around.
Prince Mamaru,
Caius repeated, replicating the accent and the strange R like he'd been practicing the language for years. Might I say quite candidly that I am simply in awe of your jewellery? It's incomparable to anything in Volstov. He reached out a solicitor's hand, likely to admire one of those bracelets, or maybe just to make another sweeping bow. I wouldn't ever be sure, since the man standing next to the prince seized Caius's wrist with the speed of a practiced soldier. I found myself reaching for my sword before I remembered two things. That the war was over, and that it was forbidden for us to carry a weapon within the Emperor's palace. Gisette's smile slid off her face like a piece of creamed eel. Prince Mamoru's eyes went wide. Caius Greylace looked as though he'd never had as much fun in his entire life, even when the man released him and bowed lower than I would have thought he'd been capable of. He murmured something in a low voice, rough and alien. I could only presume it was an apology. Fiacre caught my eye and nodded toward the door. The Emperor had arrived, standing with his 7 separate bodyguards, or poison tasters, or whatever the hell they were.
I suppose we'd best take our seats,
Gisette said. Her smile was back in place, but it was a diplomat's mask of a smile, and there was no authenticity to be found in it at all. The man muttered his foreign apology again before standing and ushering the prince to his seat. Caius turned to me with the air of a fisherman who'd caught lobsters in his trap. That was thrilling, he whispered as we moved away to take our seats.
Didn't you think so? I wonder who that man is. He moved so quickly. Perhaps he was a general or some other manner of warrior servant. He was so strong.
Thrilling, he almost killed you, I pointed out, just in case Caius hadn't noticed that part.
I know that, Caius said. Why else do you think it was so delightful?
He was the only person it was my misfortune to know who would have said almost being killed by a Kihan bodyguard was delightful or thrilling. I was beginning to despair for all of Volstov. If this is what was happening to our nobility. And I was beginning to despair for myself. If this was any example of how the rest of the talks were going to go. The younger prince had taken his seat once more. I could see him from where I was quite clearly, and his bodyguard too, in case he wanted to try anything again. I may not have had my sword with me, but then again he didn't either. The way I saw it, we could still manage to figure out how to kill each other properly with just our hands. Prince Mamoru murmured something to his brother, then bowed deeply to him. It made me feel all kinds of uncomfortable to know that we were transacting our business with the people who made their brothers bow to them on a point of formality. Then the Emperor Isil lifted his hand. Even though his father had just died, even though he was new to it and he had a hell of a lot to prove, he held himself like he'd been doing this all his life. Or at least like he'd been waiting for it that long.
Now,
he said in a voice made all the more formal by its stilted Volstovic accent,
lords and ladies of Volstov, our esteemed guests, the Kihan welcome you.
And the way he said that, I thought, folding my arms over my chest and getting ready for a long night, made it obvious that he was the Kihan. Even though he'd been a prince this morning, he was an emperor now. But those were just the times we lived in.
Kuje.
My lord, Mamoru was kind. It was always, almost impossible to apologize to him. My forehead scraped the floor of his personal chambers nonetheless. When we'd been younger and my lord more outspoken, he'd commanded me once to stop my bowing, which, after a long week that made no sense to either of us, I'd explained to him was like asking a fish to live out of water, or a songbird to keep silent. If I'd done my duty as his servant poorly, then it was my job to appease the natural order of things by begging his forgiveness.
It was a misstep, I said, my hands in fists at either side.
It was clear he did not intend to harm you, I should not have acted so rashly.
Koje, my lord said, surely you've apologized enough.
That was the trouble with my lord.
He was too kind.
The emperor had known it and had done what he could accordingly. My lord Isul, too, had tried to stamp it out. Some men, however, were made to be like Isul, and some men like Mamoru. You could no more have taught my lord imperiousness than you could have taught me to stop bowing.
Indeed, nothing came of it,
Mamoru went on, unplaiting the jade from his hair and setting it upon a low dark table. It was worn with the polish of true craftsmanship, the fine patina of age. He'd had it since he was a child, and dressed, as was sometimes the custom with second sons, in the swaddling clothes of a little girl, to see him alive and unharmed through his first 5 years. Assassins targeted sons, but left daughters in their cradles. I bowed my head again.
My lord,
I protested, if there is some fitting punishment for the offense.
Shall I make you scrub the floors all night?
My lord asked. There was a warmth in his voice I knew well. It meant there was a fond twinkle in his dark eyes, that he was, in some way, laughing at me. If I would stop my obsequies and lift my head, then we might laugh together.
But things were different now, more serious. I could not laugh off what I had done as simply as I laughed off other smaller transgressions.
My lord Mamoru was lenient with me, but I had no cause to be lenient with myself. My lord knows that I have already been scrubbed twice over for the arrival of our guests, I said, with as little humor as I could manage. It was still more of a jest than I should have allowed. Having known my lord since his birth, however, had instilled in me some treacherous familiarity that, try as I might, I found incredibly difficult to stamp out. Mamoru laughed outright this time, the sound of it soft and welcoming. It filled the silence in this part of the palace, where all the servants were either asleep or busying themselves with their last duties before bed. The wing of the palace that had once housed the princes, and was now for Mamoru alone, was kept separate from the newly disruptive intrusion of the delegation from Volstov.
I suppose there is no fitting punishment at all for what you've done then,
Mamoru mused. When I lifted my head, there was a faint smile upon his lips, his braids undone around his face. When my lord had been much younger, that face had resembled a pale, round moon, or perhaps a mountain peach. My lord, I said, bowing my head again, this time in thanks.
You might call my servants in to ready me for bed,
Mamoru said.
We hope you enjoyed this preview. To continue listening to this audiobook on Google Play Books, use the link in the video description.